All righty, here we go. We're episode four. Man, I'll say one thing. When you start doing a weekly episode or something, you become like more aware of how time passes. Like that's one thought I had the other day. I was like, it's Friday again. I was like, we're gonna record again. I was like, this is the fourth one. And then it's like, wow, like that's just crazy. And I think also you're like, the time's gonna pass either way. Like that's one cool thing if you start doing any kind of like content or whatever it is. And start like kind of having a bit of a scoreboard, you're like, whoa, we're already at four. The time's gonna pass anyways. Like, what else could I be doing? That's what it kind of makes me do. I'm like, what else can I do?
Yep. Yeah, I also want to point out, like, we're putting pretty little effort into this other than the time actually just chatting. And you and I both agreed this would be fun to do anyways, even if we weren't recording it. We like to hang out and chat and talk about business stuff and money stuff, right? And what we've done so far, I just took a quick peek. We've had like just the first three episodes that we've done on this, we have accumulated like 500 views. Right. So it's like it's something we would have done anyways for fun, but it's something that is kind of helping us out in what we're doing too. 'Cause like you've gotten some downloads for some of the stuff that you've put out there. So have I put out that little thing in the description last week. I had some people pop in and buy that. And so early this morning, I actually jacked the price way up. Still a good deal. But I wanted to reward those fast action takers. So it's like, again, like you put something together, you threw it in the description, and that's kind of cooking in the background for you. I did the same thing. And it's like, why not do something like this?
Yeah, and this
So
wasn't, yeah, it wasn't like a planned topic or anything, but I think it's, I've been reflecting on it more about how, just how you can create opportunity for yourself by kind of like this, like low hanging fruit of maybe recording something you're already doing, or maybe, whether it's repurposing content, starting to share your stuff, anything like that. The more you, as a guy I like to follow on YouTube, Daniel Fazio says, the more stuff you exert out into the ether, the more stuff will come back. So
Yeah, absolutely. I've been personally doing a better job about just putting some stuff out there about what I'm doing with, one-on-one clients and this and that. And it just creates inbound traffic, like you said. Like I know you've got the same thing. You've got people in your DMs. Like the more you post about what you're doing, the more opportunity that it creates. So that kind of leads in to one of the topics that I thought we could talk about today, because this is something that people argue about, they disagree about, and then people get stuck on it because they can't make a decision about which one is the right answer. And the question is, how do you feel about going wide versus going deep? And there's two main areas that I think this applies to. And I mean, we could apply it to everything in our business, product lines, whatever. But in the context, I think, of what I see a lot, and maybe you do too, is people ask a lot, like, if I want to get some social media exposure, should I go wide across like every single platform? A re you know resharing, repurposing, whatever. Here's an app that'll slice and dice my video so I can put it on 15 different platforms. Like, is that the smart way to do it? Or should we go deep? Should we go all in on one thing and just focus a ton of time and effort and attention on it and be really good at it, right? So wide versus deep, is there a right answer? And then I think the other thing that applies to is our brand messaging, right? Do we want to appeal to, there's when people are creating brands, like the temptation is, oh, I want to make this appealing to everybody, right? People are afraid to get really, really, really tight in their focus because they're afraid they're going to lose people. But there's a lot of evidence out there that the tighter you go, like the more it makes you more unique. And so it makes it easier for you to get a foothold. But like, what's the right balance between wide and deep in terms of messaging, but also in terms of distribution? So I'm curious what your thoughts are.
Yeah. Awesome. I'm gonna go with the first. So the first take, and it's something that I've thought a lot about, struggled a lot with, like the wide versus deep, just in like business in general. And I have a few different thoughts. I've actually I've actually kind of like changed a little bit on this, because I used to think like shiny object syndrome was like the kind of worst thing, like when you're starting out, and it can be. But being led by your curiosity and not being afraid to like sort of pivot is also really important, because sometimes when you're learning so much, or you're making new connections, like you're getting momentum, your plan might not be like, you may need to deviate from your plan and kind of take an opportunity that comes to you. Or now you start out with email, but then you get really interested in ads, and then you end up, I don't know, you find out you like making ad creatives, like kind of being that, like casting a wider net, kind of doing the different things and then seeing what you like. I think there's like a lot of value to that, and letting your journey evolve. But with that being said, if you're doing that like kind of only in like a sort of consumption sort of way without any action, then that's where it's a bad thing, because then it's always you're always getting sold on a new kind of like dream or possibility. But I think that can be, it can take away credibility from your self-belief if you kind of know you're never really taking action on any of these things. And then each time it's like this, oh, this is the thing, then you don't really do anything with it, and then it's the next thing. So what is like the takeaway there? I think it's like, as long as you're like executing consistently, even if that's like kind of on different things, then it's okay to be wide in the start, because you don't know which thing's kind of going to play out. So I think it's kind of okay. With that being said, one of the things that really got me like off the ground to making good money when I was starting to freelance was kind of being like, okay, for a second here, I'm just going to get really serious. I'm going to kind of like turn off my feelings for a little bit and get the clients that I need to get to have a legitimate income. And so I think there's seasons of that. So I did that, and I was kind of like, listen, I know it's DMs and outreach that gets me clients. I'm going to go just deep on this for a season. So that answer's a little all over the place. And then the second one with the branding, I think it's super interesting. And I'll say, and speak from experience when I say, I think going deeper is actually a little bit better, because it gives you more guidelines around what to even say. The first brand I did that was kind of more general, I just really struggled to even know what to even say. But when you go deep, you get more ideas for content and for product and for messaging. And then it's way easier to extrapolate, I think, from a specific than it is to be like the healthy brand for moms. And then you're like, oh my gosh, what is it? Is it paleo? Is it, who am I talking to? So I think go deep with the brand messaging, and then you'll attract more people.
That's awesome. I tend to agree. I kind of have a nuanced answer to this too. And man, there's so many analogies that I could use to really describe how I think about this. I'm gonna just go into one, right? So most people have heard of Dave Ramsey, right? And he gives consumer finance advice, and he's basically like, never use debt, don't use credit cards, right? That is really good advice for 80% of the people listening to him. It's really bad advice for like the 1% of people who can use that as a tool, right? Who can use it in a way where they understand the risk and reward. So for 80% of the people, I think it would benefit them to go deep on what he teaches, right? But at a certain point, if you just want to, you know, if you want to like live a regular life, not being in debt, like do what he says. It's great advice. But if you want to be wealthy, then there's a different mindset that you need to adapt. And it's kind of like that bell curve meme. You know what I'm talking about? Like there's the idiot on one side, and then there's like the
The
sage
monk
on
at
the
the
other
top, yeah.
side, and there's the normies in the middle. It's kind of like that. Like, the idiots love debt and the sages love debt, but for most of the normies, like we shouldn't get too deep into debt. And I think going wide and going deep is kind of like that. The beginners want to go wide, but it's a really bad idea for a beginner to go wide. They need to develop a couple of deep skill sets, and then they can go wide, and they can be dangerous when they go wide after having gone deep.
Yeah.
And it's hard to call what that line is, right? And I see a lot of people, they're like, well, since this one thing didn't work, I'm going to test 10 other things and I'm going to go with what works. And I'm like, if you do that, none of them will work, mm-hmm. right? Going deep is what helps it to work in the first place. And then you can stack and build on that and begin to go wide. So not a perfect answer, but like, that's what I feel. That's kind of what I believe. Like, there's a couple of things I go deep on and I got to put on blinders and stay focused, because I like to be all over the place too. So what I've done personally is something that I heard that Google does with their employees. They're like, you work for us 4 days a week, and then on Friday you can work on your own project, right? Like something fun. And a lot of Google's most valuable products came from the people's Fridays. And I don't quote me on this, but it was stuff like Gmail and like some of their really, really high value popular services were created in somebody's free time, just when they were allowed to just explore their own interest. So I think that that's important, but you got to put boundaries on it. So maybe it is your Friday. Maybe it's, you know, kind of 80-20, like you got to spend 80% of the time going deep on the stuff that you need to move the needle right now, but give yourself space to go wide. Just keep it inside of rails until the deep stuff's working. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So. Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a dance. You got to get some shit done, but also like having fun with it is important too. Like, dude, on the debt thing, it's funny. I was just talking to a friend last night, kind of some of these mindset changes. And like, this is, once again, it's like, it depends where you are on this like curve or kind of what stage you're at in your business journey. But I was serious, but I was joking, saying that if you're in debt, then like budgeting's the worst thing. If you're in business, if you're in debt, like budgeting's like the worst thing you can do. Like that's not gonna, like that is not the response that's going to turn things around. And the reason I say that is because you kind of have to just like stop playing by the rules. Like if you play by the rules, you might get back to zero. Like you might get back to baseline.
Yeah.
But like, that's not the goal. We want to go from like debt to like spring way past and then have that massive upside. So it sounds a little like, you know, crazy, but I think that's where, to your point, yeah, if you've got that set income, if you're working with that, what is it? The set, the closed pie, like there's only a certain amount of resources and you've decided that you've got this job and that part-time job, and you put this out over the next 2 years, then yeah, you've got to start figuring out how to pay your debt. But what is cool about being an entrepreneur is that you get to rewrite that whole equation. And that can be very risky and scary and exciting all at the same time. So I just, when you said that, it reminded me, because I was chuckling kind of giving that advice, which sounds like terrible advice.
Yeah.
But it's kind of how I operated. And I don't know, like,
no, it's 100% correct. Like, and it's almost like a business cliche, like from some of the big names out there. It's easier to make an extra 10 grand than to save. Like, it's easier to add 1,000 a month in revenue than it is to cut 1,000 a month in expenses.
Mm-hmm.
And for most people, they're like, well, yeah, but no, it's not, because they don't understand how to raise the top line. Mm-hmm. And so the only lever they can pull is to raise the bottom line, right? By cutting expenses. And that's where, and if that's where you are, then go listen to Dave Ramsey, right? Because he's giving good advice. But once you understand that you can simply raise the top line, and if you raise it far enough and fast enough, the expenses don't matter.
Yeah. and that has been, I don't know when that became my thing, and it was not always the most responsible thing to do.
Uh-huh.
But my mentality has always been, make more money is the solution. Yeah. I don't want to play I don't want to play the game where the coffee is the difference maker. So
sure.
That's a whole kind of topic on its own.
Just
but
one coffee a day, Ben.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, cool. Hey, I like that. Let's I think that all these themes today, all these questions are, I think, are tied together. So there's also this dichotomy in our world, two different very types of messaging. And it's funny because I see people trying to like absorb and adapt both, even though they kind of seem like opposites. And it's the difference between hustle culture, right? You know, when you're sleeping, your competitors are awake and they're making ground on you, and only losers take off weekends and blah, 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 and all this stuff. And, you know, and there's, you know who those voices are, and they're just like, you know, you got to be a lion and you got to be a killer and all this jazz. But then on the other side, you've got the 4-hour work week people. And they're like, I worked 2 hours this week and I made $100,000 on my laptop on the beach. And, you know, I took 3 months off and, you know, all this money was still coming in and da, 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 like very different messages. And I think both of them, you know what I mean? Like there's people that are kind of attracted to both, and they kind of like mix up these messages in their mind and they're trying to chase after both ideals at the same time. And it's like, I've got opinions about this, and I know a lot of people have strong opinions about this. So I think it's a fun and a funny topic. And so I'm curious what your thoughts are on this balance between hustle and 4-hour work week.
Yeah, I love this whole conversation, and I am far from having it figured out, because I go back and forth. But when you said that, it reminded me, like, Hormozi just put out a video and it was like, getting rich isn't fun. And it was just like, basically, like, it was kind of like just not shitting on it, but it was like, you think it's fun, it's not fun. And he has all obviously amazing content, so I'm not, I've gotten so much value from the guy, but I was just kind of cracking up because it sometimes feels like, from like, when you're the listener, you're trying to figure this stuff out, it's like, you can't win. It's like, you start going hard and everyone's like, you're a try hard, and like, you thought you did this for freedom, and you're like, oh yeah, I'm right, I can't even have any fun anymore. And then you slack off, and then someone's like, if you're not working weekends, like, you're gonna fail. So it's so funny. And there's kind of different, I think seasonality is another thing that's been helpful for me, where it's like, there's a time to go harder to, does it, and he said that as well, which is, you know, there could be a season of no, there's different seasons. But yeah, it's funny because I've been actually thinking about this one a lot recently. And one sort of, I guess, like, lens that has helped me shed some light on this is that it's sometimes like the wrong, it's sometimes the wrong like lens to be like, am I hustling or am I not hustling? Like, sometimes just paying more attention to your energy and what you're kind of like enjoying or what's easier to do is really helpful. And that can get a bit woo-woo because sometimes you're not going to want to do stuff and you just have to. But there's definitely things that you can kind of lean into where you might end up actually working for the weekend, but you're like, that was like awesome. Like, I was in this project or I wanted to get this done, and you can kind of lean into it. But then I've had days or weeks where I'm kind of like, what, like, have I kind of lost myself in this, like, just grinding and like life's kind of happening? So I go back and forth, I guess, but I enjoy the ride, that's for sure. And I enjoy the discussion around this, and Twitter is, you know, rife with this stuff. You get both sides going back and forth. As soon as you think you have it figured out, everyone switches in there, you know. Like right now, one of the funny shifts is the, you know, there was very much this sort of, and there still is this sort of almost religious approach to like holistic health, where it's like at all costs. And now there's almost this pushback where it's like, that's not really health. Cause like you're one dimensional now, like you can't have fun. You can't. And so now you're losing out. And so it's this like ebb and flow, but there are people though that I think that I follow, and I'm kind of like, I really like your take on, do you know Dan Coe?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Like, he's an amazing kind of creator. And actually I highly recommend like just his content for how to even think about this, because there are ways to think about it where you can, even though it can take a bit longer, work on these higher leverage tasks and then create a lot more freedom where you're not managing a big company, but you know, you start to create that audience, and then you really get to choose how you kind of invest your time after that. You know, you can sell digital products. You can have very low overhead. And so I like some of these different models that are not just, you know, if you're not like burning the candle at both ends, like you're failing.
Absolutely. Yeah, I got Dan Coe's audiobook. I haven't listened to it yet, but nice. That's on my queue. I really liked your answer, and I think it's similar to mine. I had a mentor a couple of years ago. I still follow this guy. He's amazing. But the way he framed this up, I think that hustle culture is optimizing money, and 4-hour work week is optimizing time. And what this guy said is really neither one is the thing you want to optimize for. What you want to optimize for is energy, right? And, and you said that too. If you optimize for energy, then money happens easier. And then the time that you have is usually like valuable quality time. So that's how I try to think about this. And it's difficult to hit that balance, right? There's definitely like ebbs and flows and seasonality to it. Like you mentioned, like I'm a middle-aged guy with a bunch of kids. I'm not doing the 7-day hustle, right? It's just like, it wouldn't be worth it. It would not be worth it. Like even if it was more money, that's not where I want to, it's not what I'm optimizing for, but I'm also not optimizing just for free time because I like what I do. And so sometimes I do work part of a Saturday because I'm like deeply engaged in what I'm doing and I want to finish creating something. So it really is a balance. And for all the nerds out there, Aristotle said that virtue is the mean between two extremes, but it's hard to figure out where that mean is, like where is the proper middle ground. And
yeah, because I don't think it's just like, I don't like that work-life balance. Like it's not just that. That's too simple because work can be so much like fun that maybe like your weekend is a like whatever, you're meeting up with some people or you're talking about stuff, but that's like leisure basically. So that's too simple, but I hear you.
So yeah, that's if you're in a position where you feel like you have to escape your work, I mean, that's a different, like, I don't feel like I need to escape my work. Right. And I think that's where you want to get to when work is play, then this distinction, starts to get, it just starts to not matter. You know what I mean? Cause sometimes when you're working, that is quality time and you just need to balance different types of quality time, right? Like family and relationships and, you know, what you're doing with your, work or purpose, whatever. So, I don't know if that answer is helpful.
Yeah. I want to add like a couple quick things to that. And this is something that kind of started to become clear to me as I was freelancing and thinking about the path of what to do next. And I'm thinking about kind of making this part of my personal brand is almost like this kind of anti-agency mentality, because people want money. And obviously like an agency is a great way to build like a really cash flowing business, but it can be like a massive headache where you just have a lot of bosses and you go into your Slack or your Discord and there's just messages from everyone needing something from you. Like that's not fun. And also at the end of the day, even if you're selling a quality service, like you're selling other people's products still. So I want to direct people to like, I think it was the last video Dan Coe put out on YouTube. And it was really good because he kind of made that distinction about it's always better to sell your own product if you can. So even if that's not at the beginning, that's hard to do at the start, but at the back of your mind, whether that's a physical product with like, that's why I like brand building. Then you can use these skills, this copywriting, email marketing to sell your own product. And usually that makes it more fun to work if you're selling your own product. And then I kind of lost my train of thought there, but I just think that's like a cool way to think about it too, because sometimes it can be the type of business you're building can lend itself to more like enjoyable or less enjoyable work.
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. We're not giving easy yes or no answers today, man. All right, let's do our last topic. That maybe this is an easy yes or no answer, maybe. Okay. And it's another thing that I see people get stuck on. It's something that I see the gurus argue about. All right. What should people focus on if they want to stack the deck for success? Should they focus on organic audience strategies or paid audience strategies?
Gosh. I'm going to, for this one, I'm only going to answer from my experience, not from like what I think people should do, because I have thoughts on it, but I sometimes the way you want to think about something is not what actually happened for you. So for the last probably 5 years ago now, I started doing some kind of organic content. And talk about jumping around. Like it was YouTube for a little bit, then it was LinkedIn, then it was a newsletter, then it was a podcast, and then it was back to YouTube for a little bit, and then it was trying to grow on Twitter about a year and a half ago. And yes, it probably would have been better if I had really focused and mastered one of those, but I did not. I jumped around, and I don't have a massive organic audience to show for that. But I also found it hard to, for me, I found it hard to stick to a model of organic growth that I was having fun with. I think that's like the answer. And so, had I been more disciplined, I probably could have grown something a lot more, but I was not able to personally do that. And what has gotten me the kind of biggest momentum, and that's with my brand, was getting a small amount of organic, but not, you know, nothing viral going, and then figuring out a way to leverage paid ads. I mean, that was just an absolute game changer with Facebook ads and what I was able to do there. That's not my personal brand. That is a, you know, an e-commerce brand. I think maybe that's a distinction as well. I don't see myself running ads for a personal brand that I'm still figuring out organically. So that's the way things happen for me. I'm still basically learning the organic side of things and have definitely like struggled with that a lot. So I guess that's my experience and my answer.
Awesome. Okay. No, that's good. That's good. And I'll be honest, I don't have a great answer for this, to be honest. I've done both. And what I can tell you, I do think you're right, the distinction with e-commerce. But I don't think it's business model. I think the distinction is if you've got something where you can hold it up in front of somebody's face and they instantly can say, yes, I want that. Right? If you can put up like a contrast or just some element of desire or problem solution, and people can glance at it and say, yes, I want that, paid traffic is going to be your friend. But if you have to do teaching or convincing or trust building, then it's real hard to do that. Real hard to do that to cold traffic. So you're probably going to be better off starting a fire with organic, right? Giving people, warming them up with organic traffic so that they find their way into your world and are willing to make purchases. So there's a couple factors that influence that. Again, it's like the immediate desirability of the thing that you're offering. Probably price point is in there. Like I can run ads to a $20 thing all day long and sell it, right? I may not make money on those ads, but it's easy to sell a $20 thing. If I was trying to sell a $2,000 thing to cold traffic, it can be done, but it's hard, right? But I can sell $2,000 things to my warm audience all day long. So I've done both. And I think if I was to give really generic advice, it's that there's value in starting with organic and finding something that starts to work, like finding what that connecting message is, right? You know, when I say this, then I get engagement, I get likes, I generate sales. And then if you discover what that is, it's really easy to stick ad spend behind it and not have to use ads to do research, right? Because that can be expensive. But if you're just amplifying what you already know works, then you can kind of shortcut some of that. Some of that more data-driven discovery process that any good agency would do for you, right? So that's kind of my thought. Like again, I've got friends and clients who have absolutely crushed it using just one or the other, right? So I don't think it's like one is better than the other. I think they're different tools. One is a flathead screwdriver and the other one's a Phillips head, and you just need to pick the right thing for the right job.
Nice. I like that. One thing I want to just touch on is that I've gotten like very interested kind of again in these seasons in kind of like cracking some kind of organic traffic. It's almost like a challenge, but I'm kind of like, I think I have like the skill sets to do this, or like at the pieces, I just need to kind of put this together in a way that I can make it easy to do the content. So maybe more on that later, but I mean, I'm gonna do that on YouTube like a little bit for sure with another kind of video a week on this channel, but I'm excited to explore a few different avenues for like there's people a lot dumber than me that are doing it. So sometimes I'm just like, okay, well, why can't I build an organic audience? And I am slowly. I guess my mind always goes to kind of like numbers and speed and things like that, where you can like see that growth happen. So it's a challenge, but I think it's a fun one to keep trying to crack. And it's neat seeing people kind of like, I've seen so many other people like go through that and then kind of find their thing, and then they find a channel that really like works for them. So coming soon.
Cool. That's all I got today, man.
Sweet. Yeah, no, that's great. I'm wondering if I have like a bonus one here. This is kind of a bonus. And it's kind of a plug for like a thing that I made, which is like this kind of like brand finding like roadmap. Because when you were talking earlier about the messaging, the broad or the wide messaging, and this kind of is related to the content, a lot of these different things, is that it's really neat to kind of just like stack different characteristics together to give your messaging like more direction, and to give yourself kind of a way to make your content or your branding like more easy. And that can be as simple as like in that doc, I kind of lay out like, what's like a podcast you like listening to? And then like, what's like a category of person? And then like, what's like a product they might use? And you kind of like stack those together, and then you're kind of like, okay, that's kind of like something I can actually speak to, as opposed to trying to just think about content for, an audience. It helps you get more specific with things. So I guess to kind of tie that together, I've been trying to think about how to kind of like reverse engineer some of this stuff. So it's like, it's not so much trying to think of content to come up with. It's more just like putting together that something that your ideal customer would like want to find, and it would be helpful, because you're like, oh, they would listen to this, they're kind of interested in this, and they're trying to accomplish this. And it's like, okay, well, if there was a supplement that was like themed with, I don't know, there's all these comedians popping off. What if there was like a supplement that was related to comedians? I don't know, like something like that, where you start to put these things together and you're like, okay, I could make something around this that those people would be like, that's cool. And I think that's like a helpful hack for like your ads, your branding, and your content. So that's kind of what I've been playing with.
Yeah, nice. So you're gonna, that's still linked in the description for this video.
Yeah, it's a pretty
Okay.
simple doc, but it just like basically has like these lists, and you can like pick kind of, okay, this, this podcast I like, this like category of products, and then like there's one other category, and you can circle a few of these things and then be like, oh, like that's neat. That's kind of like a brand is what you end up with, where you're like the example I give is like Jordan Peterson podcast, like education and history enthusiasts, and then like artisan chocolate. And I'm like, oh, you could do like stoic themed like chocolate, like faces of like, Marcus Aurelius. And it's like, that's kind of silly, but then it's like, oh, okay, that's kind of like, that could be a cool thing.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. I like it. I feel like we're starting this thing where we've got to have a link in the description. Like each of us have to have something that we're going to throw out there every week. So last week I had a thing in there that it was this, can't remember how I even framed it last week, but I had some people take me up on it and pay me a couple bucks for the info that I put in the description last week. This week I jacked the price up. So it's still there in last week's video and you can still get it and it's still a good deal, but I'm always going to have a reward for people who take action the week that the video comes out.
Nice.
Just to train people to watch our videos when they come out, I think.
Nice.
Right.
Nice.
So this week, what I'm going to do, I put together this really, it's a very entertaining story series of emails this week. And there's a lesson at the end that has literally helped me make hundreds of thousands of dollars. Okay. It's not going to be, you don't have to pay anything to get into this. It's just, and you don't even have to opt into my email list. All the emails are available, basically hosted on the website. All you have to do is hit the link in this video description to kind of enter the storyline and then see how that develops. And then for people who go through it this week, there will be incentive and then it'll be available next week, but I'll add in some sort of little friction point. So Nice. You guys should check it out. Not only is it entertaining, it is a lesson that has helped me make hundreds of thousands of dollars from this one lesson. So you should check it out.
Love it. Love it. I'm intrigued. Awesome. Well, I think that's a wrap for episode 4. We'll see you guys next time. Leave us a comment or a question or suggestions for topics or anything like that in the comments and we'll respond to those. But see you next time.
Later.
All right.